Grace and peace to you all. Welcome to worship here at Unity Presbyterian Church. Whether you are a lifelong member or a first-time visitor, whether you are here in the sanctuary with us or worshiping with us online, we are so glad you are here and you are very, very welcome. This morning, if you are here in the sanctuary with us, I encourage you to take a moment during the announcements and pick up the friendship pad at the end of your pew. If you would sign your name and pass it along, that way hopefully no one will leave here a stranger today. And if you are a first-time visitor with us, I would encourage you to leave an email or phone number so that we might reach out to you and thank you for being here with us today. There's a lot happening in the life of our congregation this week, lots of opportunities coming up. First, we still have a few volunteer spots for Vacation Bible School this summer. If you have never experienced that week with us, I encourage you to sign up and come and share in the joy and the energy of that event. You can find out more about what spots are available in your bulletin if you follow that link in there. This afternoon, the York County Choral Society has a performance at 4 o'clock right here in our sanctuary. It's going to be wonderful music, and we hope that you can make time to come back for it. There's information about how to purchase tickets also in your bulletin in the announcements. And speaking of music and singing, all boys and men are invited to be a part of a men's chorus coming up in a few weeks. On Mother's Day, it's Sunday, May 14th, and there is no need to sign up ahead of time or no early practices ahead of time. If you want to be a part of that chorus, you just show up the day of, and you head to the choir room, either at 8:15 before this service or at 10:30 before the 11 o'clock service, and you are in the chorus. So think about that, and I hope you will come and be a part of our joyful noise that day. And I also want to share a word of thanks this morning for Reverend Steve Simon. He is here with us, and he is joining me in worship leadership this morning. Thank you for being here, Steve, and for your participation. And now today we also have a celebration with the Women of Unity in this service, but also in the 11 o'clock service. And to tell us a little bit more about the Women of Unity and what's going on, I invite Karen Fuquay up here for a minute for mission.
Good morning. I am honored to come before you today to give a minute for mission about the women's ministry here at Unity Presbyterian Church. Women of Unity is a Presbyterian women's organization, and it provides opportunities for women to come together, to love and support one another, for study and prayer, and to give and serve. Women of Unity has a variety of small groups and circles for Bible study, book study, service projects, and fellowship. Beginning in September, there will be weekly, monthly, and every other month opportunities available for all women. There are many organizations Women of Unity supports through service and financial gifts. Some of these include the Fort Mill Care Center, York County Council on Aging, the Children's Attention Home, Historic Paradise Foundation, and Family Promise. Women of Unity also supports the Unity Preschool and the Pastor Discretionary Fund. We support Presbyterian Women USA as well. As a part of our offering this morning, you'll have an opportunity to support the National Presbyterian Birthday Offering. For over 100 years, Presbyterian women have given to this offering, and it helps support transformative efforts around the world. Women of Unity sponsors special events too. One of those is the Women's Spiritual Retreat, held this year in Montreat, September 15th and 17th. The retreat will be led by Reverend Julie Hester, and the theme is sharing our stories. The retreat will include group sessions, breakout sessions, and a special closing worship on Sunday. Registration opens June 1st. There will be representatives from Women of Unity coordinating team in the narthex following the service. Our Women of Unity web pages, found on the church website, have recently been updated to show all that the ministry has to offer. There's many ways to become connected with Women of Unity. In closing, Women of Unity is a ministry for all women. If today is your first time at Unity, we are delighted that you are here. Know that there is a place for you with Women of Unity. Maybe you've been coming to Unity for some time, but have not yet become involved in Women of Unity. Know that there's a place for you, too. Perhaps you've been a member for many years, and at one time you were a part of Women of Unity, but not today. Know that there's a place for you with Women of Unity. For those of you who have supported the women's ministry year after year, on behalf of the women's coordinating team, we thank you. God's blessing and your support make Women of Unity a thriving ministry. Thank you.
I invite you now to stand as you are able as we join in our call to worship found in your bulletin. Our Good Shepherd calls. He knows us each by name. Our Good Shepherd leads. We are here to listen and to follow. Our Good Shepherd protects and provides. We give thanks and praise for our Good Shepherd. God is gracious and merciful and knows our needs even before they are on our lips. Still, we come to this font and we practice confession, admitting to God all that rests uneasily on our hearts. Confident of God's love this morning, let us now make our confession, first out loud together, and then silently. Let us pray. Savior God, you beckon us, but we do not heed your call. You gather us, but we wander away, losing ourselves in false and superficial comforts. You speak truth, but we fail to hear and respond. Good Shepherd, do not give up on us. Redeem us, restore us, resurrect us for life in Christ. Amen. Even when we walk through the darkest valley, God is with us. God does not abandon us. Know that you are forgiven and receive Christ's peace. Alleluia. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the Psalm Book of Israel, a passage that is familiar to many of us. Let us hear these wonderful words again from Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, I'd like to invite the children who might be here with us in the sanctuary to come forward and share a special word with me on the carpet here. And if you are worshiping with us online, if you want to scoot a little closer to your screens to share as well. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. How is everybody? Doing good? Wonderful. Well, thank you for being here today. Worship is always better when you're here, so thank you for coming. This morning, I wanted to ask you all, have you all ever been to a zoo? Raise your hand if you've been to a zoo. All right, some of us have. Have you ever been to an aquarium and seen a lot of fish? Okay, some of us have done that. Does anybody have a pet at home? Does anybody have a pet? Okay, so there's a good mixture of us. We've seen a lot of animals and fish, and we might even have these pets at our home. Well, do animals need food and water and things like that? Yeah? How do you take care of your pets at home? Oh. What do you do for them? Yeah. Feed them? Yeah? Feed them water, that's good. Mm-hmm. Oh, we take care of our babies at home too. Yeah, for sure. What else? Play with them. They need exercise, right? To get all that energy out? Yeah, that's a good one. What else? Snuggle with them, because they need good rest too, right? Yeah, what else? Yeah, get them a haircut, because sometimes their fur gets really long and thick. Yeah, so it sounds like you all are experts on caring for animals. You know what's really cool? We're going to hear a passage today in Scripture that talks about the way that Jesus cares for us that week. Just like we know when our pets and animals need water and food, I always know my dog needs to go out in the morning to find the bathroom. Just like we know how to care for animals, Jesus knows how to care for us. Jesus knows when you need rest, when you're tired. Jesus knows when you need friends and family around you to comfort you and cheer you up. Jesus knows what you need before you need it. Isn't that awesome? And so we're going to hear more about that in Scripture today. And I hope that you will remember any time that you are struggling or feeling down this week, that Jesus is looking to take care of you, okay? So look for ways that you feel Jesus with you and taking care of you this week, just like you take care of animals at home, and that we see animals in the wild and try to take care of them too, okay? All right, will you pray with me? All right, repeat after me. Holy God, you are our good shepherd. You care for us and love us better than anyone else could. Help us to feel your care this day and every day. Amen. Thank you all for being here. You can head to Children and Worship or the nursery if you're going that way, or you can head back to sit with your families as we surround you with our blessing. Today is the fourth Sunday of Easter. This is the midpoint of the Easter season. It's a moment of transition between the stories in Acts that we've been hearing about those post-resurrection encounters with Jesus and the arrival of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. This Sunday is often known as the Good Shepherd Sunday. And many congregations who follow the lectionary will be focusing on the image of Christ as shepherd today. Our gospel reading comes from John chapter 10. And while this text does include Jesus as the shepherd, it also includes him as the gate to the sheep pen. And this part of John picks up in the midst of an unfolding drama. In chapter 9, Jesus used mud and spit to heal a blind man on the Sabbath. And the Pharisees heard about it, and they were a bit upset, and they came to investigate. They questioned the man who had been blind, they interrogate his parents, and at the end of the day, they can't figure out who this Jesus is and how he was able to heal this blind man and why he was breaking the rules. So they end up driving the man who had been healed out of the synagogue. Jesus hears about this and comes to speak directly to the Pharisees. He calls them blind because they can't recognize the Son of God right in front of them. So our story today picks up in the midst of that conversation and Jesus trying to help the Pharisees understand who he is. So let us listen now for the word of the Lord. Very truly, I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by another way, is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy God, we gather here and we are in awe of you, in the way that you guide us to exactly what we need. Guide us today as we listen for your word and seek to understand and follow. May we know your truth and respond in faith. Amen. I am the gate. When most people hear the word gate in relation to religion, they probably think about some image of pearly white gates floating up on a cloud with St. Peter standing in front of them. But gates are more than that. Gates are everywhere. They come in many shapes and sizes. From the baby gate that keeps toddlers from climbing the stairs, to the giant iron gates in front of palaces in Europe, to the barbed wire gates that surround prisons. Gates serve a lot of purposes, both physically and symbolically. A favorite gate to some people in this region of the world, and at least to some Presbyterians, is the gate that sits at the entrance to Montreat, North Carolina. The Montreat Gate is a large stone structure with two arches that goes across the road that leads in and out of the small town of Montreat. Growing up, my youth group started this tradition that each time we went in or out of the gate, we would roll all the windows down in the car and reach out as far as we could to touch the stone of the gate. It was a wonderful tradition, except for the year we forgot to tell our new chaperone about it, until he was slowly rolling under the gate, trying not to hit it, and all of a sudden he had several teenagers halfway hanging out of his windows, reaching out for it. It's a bit of a surprise for his first day. But truly, that tradition of touching those stones became an important ritual for us. We knew that passing through those sturdy archways meant that we were in a special place. We were leaving behind the stress of school and the struggle of fitting in, and we were arriving in a safe space to be who we are as our most authentic selves. The gateway became for us, as I suspect it is for many who visit there, a liminal space. A space that marked the transition, the movement to and from holy ground. Gates are powerful in that way. They have the power to protect or to provide privilege. They are placed on thresholds and swing open and closed to welcome people or to keep people out. One scholar shares these thoughts about gates. Gates bring to mind something that separates those on the inside from those on the outside. And for 2,000 years, the church's proclamation of Jesus as the gate has served both purposes. For John's community, those who entered by the gate that was Christ had to close the gate on the flock that remained in the synagogue. And on both sides, questions of exclusion and inclusion raged. Who was in and who was out, theologically, morally, or ethically? The scholar has a point. For 2,000 years, the church has argued these questions and set rules about who might be on what side of the gate. But to limit Jesus as a simple dividing barrier is to miss the profound promise of the abundant life that he is offering. Let's listen to verses 9 and 10 again. I am the gate for the sheep. The ones who enter by me will be safe and well cared for. Following the shepherd, they will go in and out and find good food to eat. Thieves enter only to take away life, to steal what is not theirs, and to bring ruin all they cannot have. I come to give the good life, a life that overflows with beauty and harmony. This translation is a little different from the NRSV you first heard. This is from the First Nations version, an indigenous translation of the New Testament. And I love the language here. They will go in and out as needed for a life of beauty and harmony. Jesus, as the gate, welcomes the sheep in and keeps out things that might seek to hurt them. And when needed, Jesus, the sheep sends the sheep back out into the pasture to receive the nourishment that they need. The emphasis here is on the movement. The gate opens and closes when it is best for the sheep to come in and go out, to find rest and protection, and then to go out and eat and drink. Sheep would not thrive or even survive if they were stuck in the perimeters of their fence all the time. Nor would they be safe if they had no pen to retreat to after wandering around the countryside. Sheep need both provision and protection, and the gate is the doorway to receiving both of those things. The First Nations version also says this in verses 3 and 4. The gatekeeper opens the way. The sheep know their shepherd's voice, for he calls each one by name, and they follow him as he leads them in and out of the sheep pen. Friends, we are the sheep in this story. We need protection and provision. We need care and nurture. We need guidance and grace. Christ knows exactly what we need and when we need it better than we can ever name ourselves. The gate isn't there to keep people in or out in this perpetual, unending separation. The gate is there to guide all of those seeking the abundant life promised in Jesus Christ. The gate is the liminal transitional space that allows us to follow where Christ is leading us. It's like the gate at Montreat. We move in and out of it when we need to. We go into the gate to attend conferences and retreats, looking for rest and spiritual renewal. And after having spent time exploring our faith and hearing the stories of our neighbors, we go back out of the gate again. We go down the mountain, back into the world to work and to school and to our neighborhoods. We are not meant to stay on the mountain forever, nor are we meant to toil in the world with no rest and care. This is the same pattern of movement that draws us to worship here in this space each and every week. The bell rings and the shepherd calls us by name into the doors of this building to gather here to be renewed. Then with a charge and a blessing, we are sent back out into the community where we live and work and play. The gate is the space that allows us to move back and forth between the pen and the pasture, between the protected, safe space and the place where we go out to seek more nourishment. Because Jesus knows what we need, and he provides more than we could ever need. Look at the other ways that Jesus has revealed his identity in the Gospel of John leading up to this point. In chapter 4, he is the living water. In chapter 6, he is the bread of life. In chapter 9, he is the light of the world. Water, bread, light, all elements essential to life. And now Jesus says, I am the gate. The gate is the way that we get to the water and the bread and the light. The gate allows us to follow the Good Shepherd to all things that we need for living. And not just surviving or getting by, but living with abundance. The psalmist knows this to be true, as we heard his words earlier. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Beloved, the gate is not about who is in and who is out. It's not about which side of the gate we think we are on. It's about being at the threshold of God's promises for our lives, hearing the familiar voice of the shepherd calling our name, and being willing to follow. The gate is about trusting the shepherd who has our very best interests at heart. And the gate is about allowing ourselves to be open to the revelation of God in Jesus Christ, wherever that might lead us. So today, as sheep, perhaps our task is to sit with the idea of these gates for a while. What do the gates in your life look like right now? Which gates are coming to a close to offer you protection and rest? Which gates are opening to allow you some fresh air, some light and water,
and nourishment. I think if we sit with it, we can all identify a couple of gates in our lives, those places of transition onto holy ground, where we can hear the distinct voice of the shepherd calling our names through all of the other voices and noises that would seek to pull our attention. We can hear. Christ is showing us the way. May we have the courage to follow and trust in the promise of abundant life in Christ. May it be so. Let us pray. Holy God, we believe. Help our unbelief. We love you. Help us to love you more. Amen.
Friends, having heard the word of God read and proclaimed, I invite you now to stand if you're able and join me in affirming what we believe. This morning we'll be using the words of the Apostles' Creed, which are printed in the worship order. Let us affirm our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. O holy and awesome God, we come to you this day with gratitude. Here in this Easter season, we're especially mindful of the new life that you've given us through the death and resurrection of your Son. As we watch flowers blooming and the springtime bringing new life of all kinds, we celebrate the abundant life that is ours in Jesus Christ. We are so thankful that you've called us to be your people, thankful for all of the love, grace, and peace that you've poured into our hearts. But almighty and gracious God, we come before you knowing that our world is still filled with so much darkness and evil, so much pain and suffering, so much fear and despair. The forces that put Jesus on the cross are still very much at work in the lives of so many people all around us, including many of us right here in this sanctuary or gathered with us online. But Easter proclaims your victory over death and darkness and evil. So loving and compassionate God, in the power of the resurrection, we turn to you, asking for your life-giving spirit to minister to those in need this day and always. We pray for the homeless and the refugees, for prisoners and oppressed people all around the world, for abused children, battered women, victims of crimes or racism and prejudice. We pray for the unemployed and those who are struggling with financial needs. We lift up before you those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, those who are fighting addictions, depression, mental illnesses, as well as those who face chronic illness or pain or other health issues. And Lord, we pray also for those family members and friends and other individuals who are especially on our minds today. And finally, gracious God, we pray for ourselves and ask that we might be encouraged and strengthened by your life-giving spirit. May you enable us to live in the hope and joy of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us when praying to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, one of the ways that we respond to God's work in our lives and in the world is through the giving of our tithes and offerings. This is a tangible way for us to tell God, thank you. Thank you for being our God and for calling us to be his people. As we give our gifts, we're giving God our hearts and our lives in renewed commitment. So I invite you now to give joyfully and gratefully to our great and loving God. And you can do that as the offering plates are passed here in the sanctuary or through the donation box in the back as you leave or through the QR code that's on the in print of the bulletins or through the church website online. But let's bless God now with our gifts. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given to us, our lives, our time, and our possessions, all signs of your gracious love. So receive these gifts now for the sake of the one who gave himself for us, our Lord Jesus Christ, and bless these gifts that they might advance the work of your kingdom. For we pray this in the name of our risen Savior and Lord. Amen. Thank you.
friends, we have been gathered into this place of comfort and care, and now we are being beckoned to go out once again. But we are being led by a shepherd who loves us and is continuing to care for us along the way. So as you go, remember this: life is short. We do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So what shall we do? Be swift to love, make haste to be kind, that God's light and love and justice and joy might be for you and all people everywhere. Alleluia. Amen.